Hi, Katherine.
Hi, Liz.
You've authored a series of reports on the future of learning for Goldman Sachs Research. Over the last few months, more than 90% of the global student population has had to adopt online or remote learning methods. What have we learned so far from this massive global experiment?
I think what's been staggering about the last few months is just seeing how quickly and at what scale we've seen education change overnight. Education is not famed as being a particularly fast-moving segment. The notion of having a professor standing in front of a classroom of 30 students hasn't really changed since the Industrial Revolution. And so the scale and the speed at which we've seen this, this shift happen has been really quite remarkable. The other thing I think I would really pull out is the fact that for many institutions, the idea of having a digital offering was very much seen before as a nice to have or an add-on or a bonus. But we're now moving into a situation where instead of being seen as a nice to have add-on, it's really being seen as an essential part of risk mitigation strategy for these institutions. And I think a really vital way of how they're going to deliver education going forwards.
And what are some of the particular examples that you're seeing?
Yes, I think there are a number of examples you can point to. The one that strikes me is definitely the Chinese example, where we saw a national cloud classroom created in a matter of weeks, which is a collaboration between the government, between telecommunications players, between technology players, and between e-commerce platforms. And that essentially created a support system for 50 million students to be able to learn simultaneously together, which I think is not something we've ever seen before. And at the same time, they also utilized the state broadcasting channels in order to ensure that lessons could be streamed by that method to students that didn't have internet. And then closer to home, there are companies like Coursera who have seen an over 400% increase in terms of the number of enrollments to their short course platforms. Again, I think accelerating the adoption and the acceptability of taking these digital courses as part of individuals looking to gain new skills over the course of upskilling and reskilling in their career.
In terms of higher education, the question on every college student's mind is, will campuses be open in the fall? What are you hearing?
I think there are going to be a number of different experiences that will be available in the fall semester. You have some universities like the University of Cambridge that have said they're going fully virtual until next summer. But then you have other universities that have said that they will be open, albeit with various social distancing elements in play. I think some universities have talked about staggering the sort of start dates or taking a perhaps slightly more proactive view in terms of assessing when it's appropriate to bring students back entirely. But this notion of bringing a blended version of the university experience, I think is going to look very different across different geographies, different disciplines, and different universities.
So how do you think this uncertainty will impact enrollment?
I think there are a number of factors that impact enrollments. Historically, when we've seen a period of macro deterioration or macro uncertainty, we've typically seen the level of US college enrollments increase, particularly if the unemployment rate is also increasing. Historically, that we've called that a counter-cyclical relationship. I think there is definitely a notion that that may benefit, that we may see some of that benefit come through in this period. But there are also offsetting factors. So, for example, the number of international students that may not be able to or may not be wanting to come back to an international study placement. You also have the domestic students that may seek to defer, seeking perhaps the fuller university experience and wishing to defer until that's a more likely reality for them. I know that Harvard put out a statement last week where they talked about their MBA class being down 25%. So definitely seeing a real range of different expectations coming into that fall semester. Our view is that enrollments overall will be down about 13%, as you do see the decline in international students and also in deferrals from domestic students, outweighing some of the sort of counter-cyclical benefits and the rising online enrollments as well coming into this fall semester.
Given these factors, how are higher education institutions adjusting their business models?
I think higher education institutions are facing significant challenges on two fronts. Firstly, they're going to see declining enrollments and therefore declining tuition revenues going into this fall semester, while at the same time, they're being challenged to increase their investments in the digital offering that they need to be providing over this period. So given that, I think institutions are going to really rethink what they want their offering to be going forwards. I think some institutions will look to focus on price and utilizing technology to scale that benefit over a wider number of students and therefore being able to offer a much more affordable price ticket as a result of that. I think some universities will look to specialize and really double down their investments in particular subjects or particular faculty areas where they really have an area of expertise or a niche, which will really set them apart to deliver something very unique for the education community and going forwards. So I think this is really an opportunity for universities to rethink how they want to be positioned in a post-COVID world and where they really want to focus those digital investments.
Katherine, even before the pandemic, the rising cost of higher education and the resulting debt was causing many students to question the value of higher education. How does the current situation play into that larger debate?
The skills debate is a really important one. And I think the statistic that has really stuck out in my mind has been from the BLS, which says that a third of the US workforce is expected to change occupations over the next 5 years. If you compare that idea to the population that is currently leaving the workforce, which typically stayed in the same occupation for the entirety of their career, you clearly are going to be seeing a significant shift across different industries within an individual's lifetime, and therefore the need for upskilling and reskilling, particularly as the increasing embodiment of technology within the workplace fragments the number of skills that are needed. I think that drives a very structural sort of forward momentum for skills training going forward. This also gives an opportunity to decide how they want to reposition themselves to be relevant for a much broader base of students in the future.
And finally, what other longer-term shifts do you see in higher education as a result of the pandemic?
I think there are a number of things that will come out of this pandemic. One, I think, as we have discovered in the working world, there are elements of working online that we really enjoy and are actually superior to the experience that we face in a physical convening bricks and mortar sense. But on the other hand, there are also elements of the physical experience of education that individuals really understand now that they miss. And so I think what we will see is a real shift towards blended learning. So a notion of bringing together those bits of the physical convening experience that people have missed, and also the best parts of the digital experience, and creating a much more flexible, blended outcome and experience as a result of that. The other major change I expect to come out of this period is increased flexibility within the education system. And by that I mean, as institutions have had to make these incremental investments in digital courses, I expect they're going to want to monetize them over a much wider range of students. And so I think what that will lead to is an unbundling of the traditional higher education system, whereas instead of having to commit to doing a four-year college degree, which is set over a certain period of time, has a certain cost price tag to it, I think you will be able to pick and choose modules in a much more selective way, which also will drive an improvement in terms of the affordability and the accessibility of this education going forwards.
Thanks, Katherine.
Thank you, Liz.